Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we come before you. We thank you. We love you today, and we ask that you lead and guide us as we endeavor to handle your word. We ask that you impart wisdom and knowledge into our hearts, our minds, and that you anoint us to handle your word with discretion, with skill, and with truth. We love you again, and we bless your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I am stepping in for Bishop Mitchell. He was slated to teach the class on Bishop Derrick Reeves. And what we're going to talk about today is building a strong apostolic theology. Building a strong apostolic theology. Let's turn to the book of Matthew, chapter 11, verses 28 through 29. And it reads on this wise. Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest into your souls. When we look at Matthew chapter 11, verse 29, the crux of what theology is can be found in this small little phrase where Jesus says, and learn of me. When we talk about theology, theology can be defined as the field of study and analysis that treats of God and of God's attributes and God's relationship to the universe. And so if we break it down, theology basically means the study of theos, or the study of God. And because Jesus is considered to be Emmanuel, God in flesh, then he says, learn of me. And so a vibrant theology then is going to give us an understanding of who God is, what the church's purpose is, how the church should be orchestrated according to the Bible, and what our doctrinal issues are, our promises, and the very laws of God that give us an understanding of how we orchestrate, how we operate, and how we behave in the world today. And so when we talk about theology, theology will treat of various different topics, such as examination of the study of divine things. Theology will bring us into an understanding of what angels are, what demons are. It will even deal with, in many occasions, what demon possession is, what angelology is, the different types of angels. And it will deal with salvation. It will deal with ecclesiology, which is a study of the church. As I was looking at many different organizations and many different denominations, just about every denominational group has an understanding of what they believe. Each of them have their own catechisms. If you go to the Lutherans, they have a catechism, which is a belief system. They will tell you, this is what Lutherans believe concerning salvation. This is what they believe concerning angels. This is what they believe concerning salvation. Catholics have their catechism. Again, just about every organization has a standard belief system and a standard theology, because this standard theology is what drives your teaching program. It's what drives your education program. It's what drives even the preaching. And so what we have in the Apostolic Church, with over 100 different organizations, we have a theology that is scattered and hit and miss. And that's why there are so many different theological teachings and so many different organizations, because we can't seem to agree on what it is we believe. Even our methodology of salvation, some believe that the water is necessary baptism, some say it isn't. There is a debate on who God is, whether God is a simplistic being, whether God is not a simplistic being. And when I mean simplistic, is God just a being that is composed of one thing? Most evangelicals, those who believe in a theism, and theism says that there is a personal God, a God who is creator, a God who is transcendent, he's beyond space and time. He is the creator of all things, he is absolute, he is perfect, he divine and he is eternal and infinite. Most people in Christendom believe this, but the issue with simplicity in most cases is what divides us. With the Trinitarians, they believe that God is one what? Composed of three who's. And so what they say that God is a trichotomic God composed of God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost. And all of these three composed together make up the triune God. The problem with this is if we subscribe to a simplistic God, a simplistic God is a God that has no variations, there's no difference within him. Everything is exactly the same. The Trinitarian model tells us that the Father is not the Son is not the Spirit, the Spirit is not the Father, the Spirit is not God, you know, in that reside. So you have three that make up the one God. And so the problem with this is that if you have three together that compose the one God, then neither of them can be God in and of themselves if it takes three to make up the triune God. Another problem is that if you have those three, then there are differentiation within God's being. Therefore, God ceases to be simplistic. Now he has composition. And if there is composition, then that is a structure, that is an existence that is no longer simplified. It becomes literally complex. And according to even the theological training or theological teaching from the fathers of the Trinitarians, anything that has composition has to have a composer. And so anything that has more than one element to its structure then ceases to be eternal, ceases to be infinite, because whatever is infinite has no separations in its part. Whatever is infinite cannot have anything that is uniquely different from anything else of that structure. And so the problem comes in then with this type of theology that you have one God, but God ceases to be a personal being because God now has to become three different persons that make up whatever God is. And so God, instead of being a personal God, he now becomes a conglomerate of beings or persons that agree, that share one life, that are in perfect harmony, but yet they're distinctly different. Now this is not what the scripture teaches, because the scripture in the Shema, Deuteronomy chapter 28, tells us, "Hear ye, O Lord, hear ye, O Israel, rather, the Lord our God is one Lord." And the term used there for one is the word echad. And there's a big argument as to whether this term means one or a plural oneness or a singular oneness. And because we have not understood the text or studied the text the way we should, what happens is we overlook the original language. The original language, the word echad, can mean either. And every scripture, every term in the book has to be used in accordance to that scripture where it is being used. And the national belief system of the Israelis or the Jews, they always stood on a monotheistic belief system that there was only one God. And there was never any instruction that gave any ideology that there were three persons that composed God as a triune being, where you have three individual personalities who make up a one God. And so theology then conveys the concepts and it conveys the discourses, and discourses are simply a long drawn out conversation or a teaching on something that gives you the laws and gives you the doctrinal basics and foundations that set forth a specific truth. When we talk about theology, our theological stance, and most theological stances in Christendom, believes in monotheism. And when we talk about monotheism, of course, mono meaning one, theis or theism deals with God or divinity. And so most people in Christendom believe that there is only one God. The problem with our understanding of that one God is how he has his oneness. And this fundamental problem has turned Christendom upside down. And instead of Christendom becoming a unified force in the earth, it has become a divisive force. And we're warring with one another, tearing down one another. And the only one that gets glory from this is God, is Satan. And so the discipline of theology will examine not just God, but it will examine all of reality. It will examine all of existence, and it will also examine God as the originator or the creator of all existence. Theology defines the true biblical assessment and belief system of Christianity. If you don't have a vibrant theology, then what you proclaim to be the Christian faith could very well be an error and could very well not be subscribed to Scripture. There are two major components of adhering to the Christian faith. One is what we call biblical orthodoxy, and the other one is historical orthodoxy. One of these views is much closer to the Bible or the biblical teaching than the other. And what I'm going to do is give you a parallel, and then I'm going to ask you some questions just to show what I'm talking about as far as theological diversities. When we talk about biblical orthodoxy or orthodoxy, there's two types of orthodoxy. Number one, historical orthodoxy. Historical orthodoxy says that in the past there were men now make up the Godhead, and you'll see as we go a little further. So historical theology then supposes that what these men taught and what they came up with in their councils or their conferences, this became the solidified doctrine. And the things that they taught that God now is, number one, one God, but he has three subsistences, or three individual persons within the Godhead. Number two, they came up with Jesus then is one of the members of the Godhead. And it used to be that they also stressed that he was forever, continually subservient to the Father. And so they taught that he is subject to the Father by virtue of his position as sonship. And so that meant strictly from breaking down the Word of God and defining the God. Later, hermeneutics dealt with taking the text, understanding the Word as it was understood by the Church Fathers. And so truth then became relegated to what the Fathers taught rather than what Scripture taught, because they felt that it was necessary for someone to give a greater interpretation. Many people believe that the apostles in the first century church had no understanding of the Trinity. They had no understanding of certain belief systems. They had no understanding that water baptism was not necessary. And so because they said the church from the first century was still in its infancy stage, there was a lot that they did not understand. And that's why we have to be very careful and take what the Scripture says. Jesus told them to teach whatsoever I have commanded you to teach. that's why we have to not only understand what we believe, but we have to propagate what we believe, and we have to continue to develop a biblical model of what the true doctrine of the Christian church is. You will understand, and I'm sure many of you have seen from one point to another all of the different diversities. You have some people that believe that unless you baptize in the name of Jesus, using the words, the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, you have not baptized correctly. Then there are some that say all you have to do is baptize in the name of Jesus. And so those little ideologies continue to split us, continue to divide us. And because we won't reason together through the word, we continue to fall further and further apart. Then there's things concerning divorce and remarriage, things concerning whether to a church, and she was sitting in the pulpit, and the pastor turned to her and said, "I don't believe in women preachers." And he said, "I'm going to take care of this after you're gone." Now, some people would have gotten out of the pulpit and left and gotten upset or preached it over the pulpit, but she sat there and she smiled and she prayed. And when she got up to speak, he couldn't stop her now. I mean, the Holy Ghost had fixed it very well. And when she started speaking, the power of God fell. There were about 30 people that got saved, that received the Holy Ghost. And she laid hands on the pastor. He fell out, and he was restored. And the man had been going through some physical things in his body, and he was healed. When he got up off the floor, he said, "I'm going to have to rethink my theology." There is no reason why we should be fighting about whether or not a woman can preach, teach, or whatever. There is no reason that a woman should fight. If she prays in faith, God will vindicate, because the word says your gifts will make room for your ministry. And so theology then reveals methodology. Theology will open up the understanding. Theology will give you the modus operandi, the method of operating church. Again, we have so many diversities because we don't have a single theology. We don't have a single doctrinal truth that we can all say we agree on. And a doctrinal truth has to be more than we baptize in Jesus' name, we believe that Jesus is God, because we all don't believe that. And so we have to come together and train our ministers, our pastors for the 21st century in a vibrant theology. Because theology, again, theology will determine your system of belief. Theology will determine how you see God, how you see the church, how you see the world, how you see your purpose. And for whatever reason, our circles have been afraid of education. We've been afraid of theology for far too long. And I hear so many pastors say, keep it simply simple. The gospel is simple, and the gospel is simple. But if you turn to Matthew chapter 28, starting in verse 18 and go further down, I want someone to read that for me. I'm going to show you something that we overlook and we skip. If you can read for me, please.
And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven.
All authority, that word there is not the word dunamis, it's the word exousia. All authority has been given to me in heaven and in earth. Go ahead.
Go ye therefore and teach all nations.
Stop right there. Go ye therefore and teach. And then he goes on further and says, and teaching them to observe whatsoever I've commanded you. There's two different words for teach. The first word, mathetes, it deals with causing pupils to sit and learn to become scholars. That's one thing that the church does not do. We don't compel people to learn what they believe and learn it thoroughly. The other term for teach means to bring people in, proselyte them, bring them into Christianity, and turn them into what we call converts or those disciples. Okay? Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 on down. It is important that we understand that God expects us to train our constituents. And what we have in today's time, the reason why many people are migrating out of the church is because they don't feel the church is relevant. The church has not answered their questions. It's as if we continue to just sweep things under the rug. But we have to be forthright in explaining what we believe. We have to begin to tell people what the scripture says, what thus saith the Lord. And until we do, only truth sets free. Only truth liberates. Our philosophy has no more power to do anything than anybody else's philosophy. It has to be the word of God. So, again, two types of orthodoxy. One is biblical historical orthodoxy, where we look at the text and we agree, we see, we understand what those who are in tells us, and that was written by Trinitarians, it tells us that, number one, the first century church believed that Jesus was God. Number two, they believed in water baptism through submersion. They did not have a lot of complex things that we don't understand anyway. Because first of all, when we start trying to understand God, what is a spirit? Now, if we look at the word says the spirit is like the wind. Is God wind? Is he a living mind? Is he? We don't know, and we will never know. That which is finite can never fully understand that which is infinite. Even when we get to heaven, you will never know everything about God because he is so complex, he is so profound, he is so expansive. even the angels have not experienced God in his totality, because they are not infinite. They are not eternal. They were created, and so they have limitations. And so the thing about God is we accept him by faith. We enjoin ourselves to him. We learn of him as he reveals himself, but we will never fully understand him. And that is the joy of the mystery of being with God, because he can consistently unveil himself and truth to us. Again, secondly, second type of orthodoxy is historical orthodoxy, where the men of old came together during the third century and began to develop their doctrine to combat error, to combat different philosophies. I don't believe that those who developed it were evil. They were trying to combat what was around with them. But I do believe that some things you'll never be able to understand. You accept it by faith. God is one God. Jesus is God. How he is God, we don't know, because we still have yet to fully understand how God can be incarnate in flesh and how Jesus can be in more than one place at the same time, because the scripture says that the Son of Man, no one has seen God but the Son of Man who is in heaven, and yet he's standing there on the earth. And then he says, before Abraham was, I am. And so we don't understand that. We can do our best to comprehend what God reveals, but we accept many things by faith. The general populace stresses historical orthodoxy over biblical orthodoxy. Most organizations of Christendom believe that what the church fathers did is a done deal. And that's why, again, they don't consider us a threat, not too much, because they feel that church doctrine has already been worked out. And if you will look in most books that deal with Christian sects and cults, they have the apostolic oneness listed in there because they consider us to be a cult, okay? And that's why they don't consider our doctrine. They don't consider us to be a viable threat, because it's a done deal to them. It's already done. Why do you have to rehash something that you've already finished thousands of years ago? And that's why my goal is to prove that the Apostolic Church is a viable Christian organization and organism. Okay? I don't believe we are a cult, because what the scripture says, we do. What the scripture has penned, we believe. And that's what we have to let individuals to know. So, the importance of theology, again, theology is the study of God. The study of theology will give one empowerment to see and understand God, his events, such as creation, salvation, and all of those different unique things. A good theology gives a much sounder understanding of biblical principles. Why is it do we tithe? Many people in today's time, you're noticing that a lot of churches are saying that tithing is not biblical. Now, one of the principles of the Bible is that they never dealt with that which was commonly accepted. Because it was commonly accepted, so they didn't have to deal with it. And that's why the scripture tells us when Jesus said, he said, I'm telling you to give to Caesar what is Caesar's, but give to God what is God's. There was a system in place, and that system became modified because in the New Testament, you didn't have to pay an excise on the firstborn, because tithing was a system. It wasn't just 10%. So when we talk about a tithing system, we're not under the tithing system of the law. And as a matter of fact, tithing came before the law. It came, first of all, with Abraham as a prescribed tithe. He gave tithes to Melchizedek. Okay, the tithe, the system, went from the lesser to the greater. And so when we see the system of tithes, it was already etched in stone. And so that's something they didn't have to deal with. Baptism in Jesus' name, that was already etched in stone, so it's something they didn't have to deal with. when we look at it, we see that in just about every case where they dealt with it, someone was being submerged in water. Peter, when he went to Cornelius's house, he says, "Who has water?" And he commanded them to be baptized. One of the arguments was that Jesus himself never said, "Be baptized in his name," but he did. Turn to Luke chapter 24, verse 46 through 48, and if someone would read that for me. While you're looking it up, scripture says, "Thus it is written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer to die, and on the third day be raised, and that repentance and remission of sin should be preached in his name." Now, these are the words of Jesus, and so he is teaching that repentance and remission of sin should be preached in his literal name. And then we see on the day of Pentecost that Peter almost used the words verbatim and did just what Jesus said. Now, let's go ahead and read that. I want to make sure we read it out with the text.
"And he said unto them, Thus it is written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem."
Now, these are the words of Jesus. We do that. And so our theology is consistent with the scripture. But what we have to do is become more, are you hearing what I'm saying? More consistent with scripture. Because to believe that we are in the book 100%, we're not. And that's why we have to continue to endeavor to build and to gain understanding of the biblical belief system. That's why you have people, I've never seen a day where people can be disrespectful to leadership. In our day, we would never, because we understood the office belonged to God, and that the man in the office was God's man. And when we were taught, we were always taught, "Touch not my prophet, do my prophet no harm." But in today's time, everyone lays claim to that scripture, "But touch not my anointed, do my prophet no harm." But there are 15 words for anointing, and they're different words. So what was he saying? And that's why we have to get in the text if we're to understand what he's talking about. And when we investigate that text, the scriptures really is using the word the Mashiach, which means those who have been sent to lead, to guard, and to cover. Those are shepherds. Those are leadership. And that's why we have to be very careful how we put our mouths on people, how we touch them, how we contest them, how we fight against them. Because we'll find ourselves getting in trouble with God. Okay? And all of these things are theological truths that are disappearing out of the church. I'm finding that people, when they feel it's time to pastor, they get up and they leave. That's not biblical. You have to be sent. I was at a church and I told my bishop that I felt I was called to go and be a pastor. And I saw his face drop and I told him, I said, "Bishop, but I will never leave until you send me. Because if the Holy Ghost doesn't send me, it's not time for me to go." And I meant that. And that's what I'm talking about. We talk about faith, which is another theological thing. But we have moments of faith. We have not yet learned to live by faith. If we did, we wouldn't be doing all of the fighting that we're doing. We would hold our peace and let God fight our battles. And there are so many skirmishes in the camp of Christianity. It's a shame before God. We have to teach what true faith is. And as a matter of fact, theological faith has nothing to do with what we call faith. Because the doctrine of Christ that can be seen in Hebrews chapter 6, verses 1 through 2, says faith toward God. Anyone can exercise confidence and persistence in such a way that they will go after what they want and they will procure it. But faith toward God says, if you're in dire straits, will you still trust him? Yes. If your name it and claim it doesn't work, will you still serve him? Will you still praise him? And that's where we're missing it, because we say, if we don't get all this stuff, then we're not believing. Sometimes it's not in the stuff. Sometimes God shuts the door. Why? Because it's not the stuff that makes you blessed. It's what's on the inside that makes you blessed. And until we see that, and I'm just going, biblical principles, this is what we were talking about, biblical truths. Will God heal everybody? Not necessarily. Did God promise to heal everybody? No. Is healing a part of our covenant blessing? Yes. But there are times that individuals will glorify God in death, just like they glorify God in their suffering, in their persecution. I do not believe that this 21st century church is the epitome of what the church ought to be. And we expect so much out of God when we have lived so little before God. And I believe that if we're not careful, there's going to be a shaking in our day that's going to shake the very foundations of our faith, because we've gotten so complacent and we've gotten so lax in Zion that you don't know who's saved anymore and who's not saved. And I'm not necessarily talking about the outer appearance. I'm talking about behavior. I'm noticing more in the Christian church people drinking alcohol on their birthdays. There was a young man that came to me from another church, and he said, well, what's wrong with having sex? I only have it once a year. I'm not married, but I do it on my birthday. We have dropped standards so much. We have moved so many landmarks. We don't know where the demarcations are. And now in our churches, sometimes anything goes. And that's why our power is waning. That's why our marriages are falling apart, because we don't know what to believe. We don't know what to stand on. We don't know what to exercise faith on. Our ministers are out of order. Our pulpits are out of order. And that's because there is no sound theological system to keep us in order or to keep us on track. Biblical theology enables believers to understand what to believe. One problematic issue in the church is the various beliefs that exist within the church today. There are hundreds of organizations. If you go to the Church of God in Christ, they believe the same thing. If you go to the Catholics, they may have four or five different divisions, but they still believe in Mary. They still believe in the Pope. They still believe in the Trinity. You go to the Baptists, Southern Baptists, they all believe the same thing, unless they have migrated over into a more humanistic approach. But when you go to I was recently on the internet just looking at some, and I typed in the Apostolic Church, and it hurt my heart so much I had to turn it off, because some of the things that we were doing, one excerpt showed a man throwing his jacket at the preacher, and then he ran up on the pulpit and dived into the baptismal pool. And when I looked at the comments, the people said, what a wonderful radical praise. Now, in our day and time, the pulpit, the rostrum was holding. You didn't play around the altar. You definitely just didn't dive into the baptismal pool. So we would have called that out of order. But in today's time, it's radical praise. Our theology is failing. And because our theology is failing, is causing the church to become more common. I don't know what's going on in other parts of the world, but we have churches now, and many people are leaving the standard church to go to these churches, because in these churches, you can come as you are. That means with rollers in your hair, you can have your pajamas on with a jacket, and in some churches, you come in, they sit out coffee, and you can take your coffee, your food, and sit in the sanctuary and eat while service is going on, or sit in the cafe and listen to the service through speakers. And so we have caused church to become so common that now we're developing our programs to please the people instead of pleasing God. And so a theology is necessary to define what the house of God is. Theology is necessary to define behavior on the altar. Theology is necessary to define how we conduct ourselves in the pulpit, how we conduct ourselves in the church. I've never seen a time where so many people in the middle of a service will walk out and you're hearing so many ringtones, phones ringing, people sitting in the back talking on phones. It is because we have lost the legacy that the house of God should be holy. And I'd like for you all to answer that. Anyone over here? Do we have a pluralistic belief or a monadic belief?
Monadic.
How many of you say monadic? Now let me tell you what monadic means. I know you see the word. how we conduct our marriages. I want that. And so you have a lot of people that have to be quiet. You can never have a doctrinal discourse because people don't know what they believe. We don't know what the other person believes. And if you get all of that in the room, the organization might just go in separate ways because we're believing different things. And that's why you younger generation, you're going to have to pray. You're going to have to ask God's blessings on us. Because I'm going to tell you, there's a reason why the apostolic doctrine is being fought the way it's being fought. The apostolic doctrine used to be one of the only structured faiths that demanded a change, that demanded accountability, that demanded righteousness, that demanded a decorum that was respectful. In other organizations, it wasn't so much about holiness, it was more about being politically correct. And that's why they said we were legalist. And we picked it up and said, I'm tired of legalism. Well, I have news for you. The scripture says that when you're in a covenant is a legal document. Everything about the church is legalism. You want to know how? Because a covenant is a last will and testament. It is a legal, forged, what, agreement, signed in blood and life. When we talk about Jesus, the scripture says that he is a high priest. He's still making, what, intercession for us. The scripture says that there are three laws that Christianity has to abide by. The law, he says, He says, now there were 10. You couldn't keep that, but I give you these three laws. He said, number one, love the Lord thy God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. Number two, love your neighbor as you love yourself. Then he said, I give you a third law. Love one another as I have loved you. That's still law. The laying on of hands, transmission of authority is still law. And so there are laws to Christianity. And we are steeped in laws. We talk about the law of sowing and reaping. We talk about the law of sin and death. There are laws. And so there must be some accountability. There must be an understanding of who and what we are and how we conduct ourselves. In many of our churches, there is little to no understanding of theology. When I ask the question, are we monist or are we plurist? Just about everybody said monist. And that is a pantheistic point of view. That's what the Buddhists believe. That's why they don't eat meat, because animals have a soul and they believe in transmigration. So I might be eating someone who's working their way back into reality, so we'll just eat the grass. They don't believe in hurting spiders. Why? Because everything in the circle of life to them is one. Now, the scripture says that God told the people in the Old Testament, he said, I have given meat for you for food. And that lets us understand that that's not our belief system. What do we believe concerning faith? What do we believe concerning gathering ourselves together? What do we believe as far as salvation? What determines salvation? Some, we did a consensus in our church. Our church, we had people that have come from other churches and people that were raised in our church. And one Sunday school, I was teaching ministers, and I asked, how many of you believe that the water is necessary for salvation? And then I said, how many of you don't? Class was split right down the middle. There are some apostolics that no longer even believe that water baptism is necessary, period, nor speaking in tongues. And so we're dealing with something in the 21st century. It's almost like in Deuteronomy. There is a generation who never knew the law. There's a generation now that's being raised that never knew holiness, that never saw the works of God, that never saw the anointing in action. And what has happened, we have siphon things from a lot of other places, on TV, from churches that we've visited, and we have a theology that's almost like a quilt. It's mixed with so much stuff that people are spiritually ill because they've eaten off of so many tables and they don't understand. And so when we talk about theology, theology is going to bring us to a point where we gain some understanding of what the church is. I teach that the church is not just the called out, because God never calls you out and doesn't call you to something. He didn't say, Abram, come out of Chaldea world and just keep wandering. And when I make up my mind, I'm going to send you to a place. He called him out to go to a land that he would show him. And so when you talk about church, if you really look at the text calls the church the ecclesia, the called out. But then you find in another scripture, the Greek term for church is the episunagoge ecclesia. In other words, the superior gathering or synagogue of called out, who are called together to assemble themselves to handle the affairs of the kingdom. And so you can be called out and never come together. That's why the scripture says, and don't be as some who refuse to come together as in the time of provocation. He said, forsake not the assembling of ourselves together. But there are people that are promoting, and these were apostolic people in the city of Columbus. They were saying that everyone who worships in a church, they're not biblical. And they're in error because the first century church worshiped in houses. And they looked at me and asked me, now, what do you have to say about that? I said, first of all, Paul preached in the synagogues. He made it his business to preach in the synagogues because he went to the Jews first. I said, you have to remember that the church was something other than the Jews. And so they had no buildings to go because it was a all different churches, and that's why I believe even when you come together that way, you have to train people. And this one young lady came in, and there were some issues with her, but I believe that before we start labeling things as being demons, we need to understand, first of all, what are some of the problems that may resemble that. Everything is not a demon. Some people are alcoholic fetal syndrome, some people have bipolarism, there's all kind of problems in the church today. And if you don't have discernment, you'll be trying to cast the devil out of everything that walks through the door. Now this sister had a real demon, and she came in, and some of the sisters that were working with her were not prepared to. They took her in the back room and they started going through all of the shenanigans that people go through. And when she fell on the floor and began to growl, and the first thing they tried to do is hold her down. You're not going to hold a demon down. Demons are strong. The scripture tells you that they can break chains, they can break fetters. And so they're trying to hold her down, got the knees on her arms, and she did like this, and they flew all over, and she took her hand and threw a desk across the room. And of course, they came running out and they started to try to get the elders to come in. And there was so much fear in that room. One person took the Bible and hit the woman on the stomach and said, in Jesus' name, I said, put her out. Listen, if you don't have sense enough to know that the Bible has been published somewhere here on the earth and it is a book with no power, it has no power. And if you have to resort to hitting somebody with leather, you don't have power. The power is in the context of the word, not the book itself. And I said that to say this. There are individuals clear across the land now. There was a case where an individual, two individuals, they tried to restrain a little boy that they said was possessed. One of them sat on his chest and inadvertently put his knee on the chest, crushed the sternum. There was another case where these individuals were trying to set these individuals free. They were children. They had them in the car, and we were talking about that. And they couldn't get the devil out, they said. And so they believed that God told them to take a knife and stab them. They stabbed, I think, two of the children, and the rest of the children, the neighbors, heard them hollering and came to their rescue. But these individuals were of the church, and then when the news media questioned the pastor, the pastor said, there's nothing wrong with the church's beliefs. And they asked him, well, were they following the church's beliefs? He never distanced himself from it. He said there was nothing wrong with the church's beliefs. And so what's happening, we have a lot of people who are self-taught, self-studied, and they got it all wrong. Two children are dead, and then the third was dead. And I'm going to close with this, and I know it's the dinner hour. We had a situation in Columbus. I had left the pulpit. I had to go downstairs and take care of some things. And I came back up, and this young man had been terrorizing the whole service. And I got irate because you have a front row full of deacons and ministers. You have people in the pulpit. And when I got back up, they said, Bishop, he's been crazy. And I had to get ready to preach. We were at a visit. We were at another church. And he had danced, grabbed the ushers, and he was dancing with the ushers right there on the floor. He was pulling on, you know, private parts of himself, and he was running around trying to get the choir to sing. And you know how we do apostolic, too. He was scooting down the seats, and Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. We don't even believe the power in that man, because with all the people in there saying, Jesus, that demon should not have been able, even if he had a mental problem, he should not have been able to keep going with the power of the name of Jesus. And I sat there as long as I could, and I started getting irritated. I said, now, how am I going to preach behind all of this? And so I stood up, and I was trying to give the pastor his time to fix it. And I stood up, and I started, I said, he's not going to mock the service of God tonight. And I started at him, he started at me, and he said, cast him out. And I raised my hand, I said, before I could get Jesus out, he fell down, started shaking, and his family rushed in and snatched him out and left. And we had church after. I rebuked a few people. You don't let the devil come in and tear up your service and bring everybody in there under arrest. So I did some teaching, but I did some rebuking. It's time for us. We're not apostolic in name only. We have to get back to that power. And there is a theology of power. And I think we're losing it because we've lost our identity mingling with so many other people. Mm-hmm. That's fine when you're trying to win them over. But when our people don't know what we believe and they see them in our pulpits, then what happens, they go to their churches, if their churches are larger, because they say, well, they have the same thing we have. There is a difference.
That's right.
And we're going to stop right here, and I hope you got something out of it. If you have any questions, we're going to take questions for a few minutes.
I just have one coming, like, on the demons. I grew up under, which put the Jones.
Okay. Oh, right.
Philadelphia.
Yes.
And he would literally cast, you know, shut them up in service.
Yeah.
And then as I got older and started going to these other churches, apostolics.
Yeah.
And I'm seeing demons just corrupting the service and nobody doing anything. And I'm like, what is it? And then they'll tell you, well, there's no
people would fall out on the street. See, I have a problem if the power only works in the church.
Right.
It should work everywhere. And this is what we're not saying, because I don't think that people understand or they believe it. And that's why we have to get back to that. Any more comments or questions?
When you talk about the historical, then you talked about the Orthodox. And we know we fall under the biblical.
Yes.
Correct. And so when you talked about the monolism, and you said that's like the
pantheon. Pantheon. Yes.
So that doesn't really consist with what our doctrine is. It's just that that's what that word, when we say monolithic, it doesn't apply to the doctrine. No. Is that what you're saying?
Most Christians that are considered Christians are considered to be theist. And they are theist that have a pluralistic belief. Because in a lot of different church organizations or religious world, there is an understanding that the universe has always been. The universe is eternal. This is what some scientists are trying to say. And that what they call the Big Bang Theory was simply the universe coming into visible state where it could be seen. Okay, and the importance of this is we have a lot of young people that are coming up in colleges and their professors are teaching them this, and it's confusing them, and it's confused a lot of us. We still are witnesses in the earth, and we still have to reach those who are fallen. And this is an information age, and we cannot be in the kitchen shaking a bag of fish, frying it, and then writing Jesus saves on the back of it. We have to modernize our method, not changing the message, but we have to come up to the times and become more thorough in what we do. Okay? Because if we just keep preaching to the crack, you have to take care of them. And most churches, we don't have a budget that way to take care. We need to expand who we witness to. And to reach them, you're going to have to deal with them where they are. And that means you have to have understanding of what you believe. And I don't mean you have to study everything they believe, but if you know what you believe, you ought to be able to counter what they believe. Yes?
Yeah, in doing that, being able to witness effectively,
yes,
when we go out,
yes,
then we're going to have to go back to really understanding the theology,
exactly,
of our doctrine.
Yes.
So then that would include more teaching to,
yes,
those that's going out, like the ministers.
Yes.
Well, to everyone, but
exactly,
definitely to our ministers that are saying they're calling and they're going out.
Yes. I think we failed when we did not, now they used to do this, I think we failed when we did not put together a belief system that was taught through all. Okay? The Catholics have a catechism, and everyone is required to learn it.
Right.
They preach it, they teach it, and in some organizations, they teach and preach the exact same thing every Sunday. Now, I'm not necessarily prescribing to that, but I do believe that we have to get serious about educating our people, because a lot of people don't understand. I see women, when they're being prayed for, men laying hands on their chest. We were taught, you never do that.
Right.
You have a lady to do that. You lay hands on their hand. But there are a lot of churches that are doing that now. And it scares me, because it makes me to know that we have a lot of people unprepared are leading churches. And you can only produce what, you know, you definitely can get sued. You can get sued now. That's why you have to make sure you put on your little bulletin that we believe in laying on of hands and the moving of the Spirit, because people have gotten sued when somebody laid hands on them and they failed and they got up and they said that they were hurt and they took the church to court and won. And you have to be very careful now also when you get on and you start telling, and I don't know if I should say this, because